Thankful to be in your house again this morning, Lord. We just thank you for the will, desire to be here. Lord, we thank you for the reason that we're here, Lord, that you're worthy of our worship. Father, we thank you for the providing a Savior, Father, that we can become close to you, Lord, that we can experience remission of sins, Father, that the thing that separates us from you. We just pray, Father, this morning that your word be broken and we'd be able to accept it into our hearts and understand it. Lord, we thank you for providing that for us, Father, the easiest way to communicate with you. Lord, we thank you for your prayer. We thank you for hearing those prayers. And Father, many of those that we've got lifted up to you in requests for healing, Father, for direction in lives, Father, for other things that we have on our hearts and our minds. But we know you're capable of providing for those. Father, we just pray that our worship service would be pleasing to you, Lord, that we'd be able to separate our minds from the world, Lord, and just concentrate on you for this time. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. All right, you may be seated. First of all, welcome all of our guests, especially all of our guests over here to my right. Thank y'all for coming. It's always great to see y'all here today. So, announcement-wise, only two announcements I have is I've been made to bring up the fact that the two restrooms back here to my left, y'all's right, are out of order. If you need to go use the restroom, you need to go in the back or in the fellowship hall. It's just studs. They've started. It was a bunch of studs and they're working here, saying that right? Yeah. It sounds like tearing it down. Sounds like they had fun. They did the demolition part yesterday and they're going to do some upgrades on those two bathrooms. So they're out of order until further known. So please just stay away from those two and everything will be fine. Also, tonight, make sure you're here, 5 o'clock for our Bible lessons. And then Ed Stevens offering day. All right, I'll put this on the back bulletin board. Be September the 18th, so please be in prayer for that. We'll be some further announcements up until that point. So that's for Ed Stevens Global Missions. We take up that offering every year. Is there anything else that needs to be announced? All right, if I could have my two ushers come forward, please. Ask Brian Barry to have the prayer
offer. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day and all your blessings. Thank you for the opportunity we have to serve you and just to worship you. We pray that we would set aside anything that's happened to us up to this point. Anything outside these walls, we just push that away and just give all the focus to you and your worship. And we just pray that you would use this offering we're about to take up, this form of worship too. Just is all for you. And we pray that you would bless the efforts here, bless the money that we collect, that we can go out and reach a lost and dying world for you. Forgive us, we're afraid. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Doesn't matter what you've heard. Possible is not a word. It's just a reason for someone not to try. Everybody's scared to death when they decide to take that step out on the water. But it'll be alright. Life is so much more than what your eyes are seeing. You will find your way if you keep believing. I see dreams that move the mountains. Hope that doesn't ever end, even when the sky is falling.
Yeah. just don't know, because I can remember seeing my grandmother sitting in a rocking chair. She would take the little babies to bed. Mm-hmm. She'd rock them babies, and boy, just pat them on the bottoms and sing, "Where Can I Go But to the Lord?" Yes. I'm so glad that when things get dark and things get hard, I got a God I can go to.
Amen. Amen.
And I just don't see how people do it that don't have the Lord. Amen. I just don't see it. But boy, I'm glad I have him.
Amen.
And I'm glad I got him in my heart, and he directs me and he guides me every single day. And I thank God for the Holy Spirit that I feel here this morning.
Amen.
He is in this place.
Amen.
Amen.
There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know. Everything I need, you got. There's honey in the rock. Praying for a miracle, thirsty for the living well.
Trust
trust in Him. He's Amen. What's going to get you through.
Amen.
Nothing else.
Praise you, God.
Thank
Praise
you, Jesus.
I have tasted all that this world has to offer. To leave you wanting more, you can't satisfy. Father, forgive me for taking so long to see. You're all I need. With every heart beating my chest, Lord, I surrender all that. For and we are so glad to have you guys today. Would y'all like to introduce
your little one to the congregation?
Sure. This is Daughtry Adair Brady. And she will be a month old this week.
All right.
And I know great-grandparents and grandparents are excited, and this is all a part of Jeanette's birthday that's coming up in another week. I hear you're going to have a three-week-long birthday, right? Okay. They have filled up this corner over here.
All right.
There you go. Well, we are so glad that you guys are here today, and just we hope that you feel at home. And guys, this is what we've been praying for.
Amen.
We've been praying for this little one, so we're seeing an answered prayer this morning. God bless you. Thank you for coming.
Amen. All right. Okay. It's hard to get outstaged by a little baby that's almost a month old, so I got some ground to make up here. So you guys come and get ready for Kids Church, and we'll look at a scripture this morning. We're going to look at Hebrews chapter 4, verses 11 through 13. So if you want to turn your Bibles to that scripture, we'll kind of go back and look at what we did last week. We've been talking about the spiritual disciplines here. We have five spiritual disciplines on these yellow sheets here. Prayer, worship, evangelism, Bible study, and fellowship. We have done messages on prayer and worship and evangelism, a message last week on the Bible. We're going to talk about Bible and the Bible study this week again. And everybody's got their yellow sheet, right? I'm sure you do. And you, at the beginning of this, we rated ourselves where we thought we were to where God wanted us to be. How are we in our prayer time and our worship and so on? Where do we stand and how can we improve? And that's what these few weeks have been about, is about improving our walk with Christ and improving in these spiritual disciplines. So, going to talk about the Bible again and how important Bible study is. Last week, remember what we did last week? How many of you remember this?
Yes.
Remember? Okay. And we used our fingers as examples. Some people can't use their fingers for good things, but we used them good last week. And so, Ashley, and so we talked last week about why we should do Bible study. And you remember what they were? Bible study brings us knowledge of God. And God wants to reveal himself to us. So when we study the Bible, we're doing exactly what God asks us to do. And the Holy Spirit reveals who God is and what he's doing and that sort of thing. So we begin to know who God is. Bible study brings us to that place. Bible study brings us to near to God. We need a relationship with God. He wants a relationship with us. And so relationship is what it is all about, right? James chapter 4, verse 8 says, if we draw near to God, he'll draw near to us. That's what the second one is. Bible study draws us near to God, and God near to us. The next one is an O for obedience. When we study the Bible, we know who God is, and we develop a relationship with him, and we draw near to him. We come to this place where obedience comes into question, and we want to be more obedient to God. We have a desire to serve and to be obedient with God. And Bible study brings us to this place. We obey because of the relationship. Who remembers the two verses from John that we talked about last week that were kind of different? Remember? I'm going to read them to you anyway. John chapter 14, verse 15 says this, if you love me, keep my commandments. That was John 14, 15. Now we look at John 15, 14. And it says, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Easy way to remember that. Both of those verses say the same thing. And it's because of our relationship with God, we desire to be obedient to God. Not because we don't try to be obedient so that we can gain a relationship with God. We already have that. And if he's living in us, we're studying the word, he brings us to this place of obedience because it's just a natural thing to do. And speaking of natural things to do, the next one is a W for witness. K-N-O-W. I don't know if you noticed that last week. I didn't mention it last week. It spells a word. So we can know when we study the Bible. We can know who God is, what he desires for us to do. We can be near him and draw into a close relationship with him. We can have a desire to become obedient to him and serve him. And then we become witnesses. And I mentioned last week how as we grow closer to God, it should become natural for us to witness. Yes. 1 Peter 3, 15 and 16 says, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. And so we
we naturally, when we've had this, we have this knowledge of God and this close relationship with Him, this desire to obey Him and serve Him, it's natural for us to become effective witnesses for Christ. And so Bible study is important. That's the whys of Bible study. It's important to every believer to be effective in the kingdom of God, right? So that's why we study the Bible. We're going to talk about how we can study the Bible today. And the first part, I'm just going to throw a bunch of stuff out there, and I'm making suggestions, and there's plenty of ways to study the Bible, plenty of good Bible study tips that I could share with you. I'm going to do the first couple of the parts real quick, and you're just going to have to listen quick. If you want to write these down, you can. And if you don't want to, that's great too. So get ready for that. And I'm going to read a couple of verses and talk to you about the Word of God real quickly. Ephesians 6, 17. Who knows what's in Ephesians 6? We talked about it in Sunday school. Again,
armor of God.
And one of the pieces of the armor of God is the sword of the Spirit. And how many of you, when you think about the sword of the Spirit, you think about this big, long sword that you whack people with? That sounds cool. That's not what it means. That's not what the word means. The sword of the Spirit, the word that's used, translated sword here, is like a small dagger that you would carry on your side, and it's to be used in hand-to-hand combat. That's what I've been reading. It's kind of interesting. And to use that, and you're in hand-to-hand combat, everybody's wearing armor, you've got to find a vulnerable place to... Is this okay to talk about in church? This vulnerable place to stab somebody to overcome the enemy. That's maybe not church topic, right? So I'll tell you a story real quick. I used to work, and I used to build swimming pools. And I did that in the summers when I was in college, and I worked with this guy named Ross. And Ross had some issues. He was an alcoholic, and we had to go and pick him up wherever he turned out to be on Monday. And he would not be in good shape, and you understand what I'm saying. And we would go pick up Ross, and Ross would have a hard time the first couple of days of the week getting back to normal and being able to work. And Ross had trouble with the law. And he was in a penitentiary for a while. And he would tell me stories about the penitentiary that I didn't ask him to tell me, and I didn't really want to know, but here's one. He said, a lot of people think you should carry a knife with you, you know, in case somebody attacks you. You could cut them with a knife. He said, uh-uh. You carry an ice pick. And I said, what? So yeah, you can just poke in a couple of places and hit all the major organs and you're done. I said, that's great. Thanks, Ross. And I would kind of be taking steps back as he told me that. I wondered if he had the ice pick on him at the time. I say that because it reminded me of that story when I read about this small dagger that you would only use it in hand-to-hand combat. It's kind of interesting to think of the sword of the Spirit in that way. But aren't we in hand-to-hand combat with the enemy every day? Aren't you in conflict with the enemy? When you try to do good things for God, you're in conflict with the enemy. You have an opponent. He's like a roaring lion, the Bible says. He's seeking whom he may devour, and he wants to devour you. You have to have the sword of the Spirit. Think of what Jesus did. I'll tell you that one in a second. Look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 and 13. Let's read those to you real quick. For the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, think of the dagger, piercing it into the division of soul and spirit, the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. There's no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. So you've heard those verses before about the word of God. And I want to tell you about the word. Follow me here. I want to tell you about the word. I was listening to a message from a guy, I think it was David Jeremiah. He was talking about this. I thought it made a lot of sense. He said the word that's translated word here, W-O-R-D, is really more the sayings of God. And it's like the rhema word of God. It's the things that God has said. And a good way to picture that is to think of of Christ in the desert and his temptation. How did he fight the enemy? With the words that God had said. Because he would say, God has said, man shall not live by bread alone. He repeated the sayings of God. And so we have, when you think about the dagger and the sword of the Spirit and the word here, because the word is the sword of the Spirit, right? We think about these sayings of God that we have that are offensive weapons in our arsenal, if you want to put it that way, if we're soldiers. We think about how these verses say that the Word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. We think about that dagger poking into vulnerable places in our lives, right? And there's no creature hidden from his sight. All things are naked and open to him, the eyes of him to whom we must give account. So I want to give you some ways to study the Bible, but I want you to be thinking about these verses. Because we're accountable to the living, written Word of God, and we're accountable to the God who's a living God who wrote them. Right? You know what I'm talking about? We're accountable to the Word of God because God is the author. We're accountable to God. We're called to believe and obey the Word, and it's going to be the Word that is going to judge us. For those who are disobedient and don't follow Christ, the Word will be their judge. The Bible calls Jesus the Word too, right? In 1 John, John chapter 1. So we're called to believe the Bible. And so I'm saying all that just to let you know how important it is that we study the Bible. We've got to practice the discipline of consistent and purposeful and focused Bible study. It's important. So let's talk about some Bible study methods. Just going to go really quick, so listen real quick. First one I've selected, and Carol teaches a class at CTI, how to study the Bible. I looked through her notes, and I looked at some other books and that kind of thing. How to study the Bible. First one, first method is observe, interpret, and apply. You observe what you're reading. Look at what's going on in the situation. You try to interpret that. What does it mean? Right? And then you apply it to your life. And that ought to be a really good general understanding of how we should be studying the Bible. We need to look at what's going on in the Scripture. We need to interpret it. And then we need to apply it to our life. If we leave any of those things out, we're not having a really good Bible study day, right? So we've got to apply the things we learn. And that's what it's about. The next one I want to tell you is about reading and marking. I heard R.C. Sproul gave this one. He said, you read the Bible, and you can apply this to the Bible as a whole book or to a single book of the Bible, a single chapter of the Bible. But read the whole thing that you're reading. We'll say the Bible. Read the whole Bible, and as you're going and reading, mark the things that you don't agree with. Mark the things that you don't really understand, and mark the things that challenge you. And then when you're done reading the Bible or reading that book, whatever you're doing, go back and start again and look only at the things that you marked. Because you either need to study them more, you need to understand them more, you need to align yourself with God's Word. Yeah. And you need to align yourself with the things you don't agree with, you need to study the things you don't understand, you need to embrace the things that God has challenged you with. So that's one way of studying the Bible, to read and mark it. Then, how about this way? How about if you just said, I'm going to study the Gospels, the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I'm going to read those because they're the story of Jesus. Now, Jesus is prophesied in the Old Testament. There's plenty of other verses that talk about Jesus. You look in Revelation, they talk about Jesus. All the letters talk about Jesus, and they should. But when you look at the story of Jesus here on the earth, you find it in the four Gospels. You can find out who Jesus is, what he taught, what work he completed, and what work he left uncompleted for us to finish, right? And so we can study the Gospels to find out who Jesus is. We can do a topical study. I know there's nothing interesting going on in the world right now that we need to know as Christians how to explain God's position on. There's nothing, absolutely nothing, that fits that criteria. And you know I'm kidding, right? But we can do a topical study. What does the Bible say about blank? Whatever's in the blank for you. Because the Bible has something to say pretty much about everything. So we could have a topical study. We could outline a book of the Bible or outline a chapter in the Bible, right? What are the main things? What are the key teachings? What are the major topics that it covers? What are the key verses in that scripture? And then just for one more thing here, don't just read the Bible. You feel free to use commentaries and concordances, Bible dictionaries, a harmony of the Gospels. That kind of compares all the Gospels together. It's kind of a cool thing to have. Any sort of Bible study book that you can get that's from a reputable author. I've got two at home that I really like. What the Bible is All About, I think that's by Henrietta Mears, and then The Mighty Acts of God, and I didn't write down who wrote that, but I like that book. Those two books are great, and they help you in addition to studying the Bible. They explain what the Bible means. So use those methods. Choose your own method. You know, the big thing is choose a method that works for you and do it and study the Bible. Because again, we're accountable to know what the Bible says. We're going to be judged by what the Bible says. So let's talk about Bible study habits. I told you I was going to go really quick. Here's another quick one. What's the best time to read the Bible? There's two times you should read the Bible. There's only two. Y'all didn't know that, did you? I found that out. She knows what they are. You read the Bible when you feel like it, and the other time is you read the Bible when you don't feel like it. That's the two times that you read the Bible. We need to commit to a diligent and consistent Bible study. Set goals for ourselves. Be disciplined in it. Set a standard time and place. It needs to be in prime time. And what I mean by that is, don't save the end of the day when you're already yawning. You lay down in the bed, prop your head up on a pillow, and here, I'm going to do my Bible study. Kind of like some of you do on Sunday morning, right? Don't save that worst time, possible time of the day for Bible study. Give God your best. Do it in prime time. And also, don't do it where there's going to be a lot of distractions. Don't try to watch a ball game or a movie or listen to music while you're studying the Bible. When you multitask, I don't think you task as well. Sometimes you have to multitask to try to get everything done that has to be done, but you need to be focused on your Bible study. Right. No multitasking. Remember the thing I said about prayer? My multitasking while I'm driving and I see the squirrel go by and I'm completely distracted. Where was I, Lord? Okay, I think I was here. Right? We don't need to be multitasking when we're studying the Word. So you choose a time and place that's good for you. Find an accountability partner. It may be your spouse, it may be a friend, maybe somebody you work with, that you can talk to at least once a week and say, how's your Bible study going? What'd you study in the Bible this morning? You might do it on a text message. Hey, I found something cool in the Bible. Here it is. Look at this verse and tell me what you think. It's great to have relationships with people like that that keep us accountable for studying God's Word. Above all of these things, and I want to emphasize that this is really important. You need to write down. You need to have a spiritual journal. Because you need to write down things every day. When you study the Bible every day, you should be writing down what God said to you. What did God say to me today? What did He promise me today? What promise did I read? What command did He give me that He wants me to do? What principle did I learn, and what is my plan to implement that principle into my life? That should all be in your spiritual journal. And see, all these things are Bible study methods, tips on how to study the Bible, habits that you need to form as a disciple of Christ, because we're accountable to the Word of God. We need to know what's in it. We're going to be judged by it. But this message is not about those two things. That was like the pre-message, Brother Wayne. I want to give you two warnings about the Word of God. And I think they're important. Again, I'm going to give you two warnings and a promise. How's that? The first warning is that real Bible study is going to change your life. In fact, real Bible study is intended to be life-changing, isn't it? So if you're thinking that you're going to read the Bible and just get some enjoyment, and it'll be enjoyable, but at times it's not going to be enjoyable for you, it's going to change your life. And you may not want to change in that area of your life, but God is going to demand it. God wants us to know His Word in order to change our lives. You think about it. Christ started the work on Calvary to redeem mankind. He put everything in place that is needed, and now we're called to go out and spread the gospel of Christ. There's work that we're called to do. He's getting us ready as we study the Word, as we work on these spiritual disciplines. We're becoming better disciples for the sole purpose of going out and telling others about Christ and making other disciples, like the Great Commission says, and being the most effective we can be for God. How much time do we have? Who knows when the world is going to end? Anybody? You know? How about your life? When is that going to end? Anybody know? So how can we sit around and not tell people about Christ? How can we not tell the people that we love the most about Jesus? Right. Because we don't know how much time they have. We don't know how much time we have. We don't know how much time the world has. So we're called to do that. And so this Bible study is important. The Word is, as we study the Word, it gives us power to be witnesses, right? God wants us to be changed. He wants us to be set apart. He wants us to be empowered. He wants us to be following the Holy Spirit so that we'll say the right words at the right time to the right person. The person whose heart has been conditioned, whose soil, the soul of their heart has been conditioned, ready to receive the seed of the Word. When we follow the Holy Spirit, that's what happens. Real Bible study makes us mature in our walk with Christ. Makes us more useful in the hands of God. So the warning is, when you study the Bible, it's going to change your life. Real Bible study is intended to change lives. So let's talk about the Word for just a second. I want to look back at those verses that we looked at earlier in Hebrews chapter 4. So look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. Look at those two verses really quick. It describes what the Word is. And I like these verses because they are they're very descriptive, but they are comprehensive in what the Word is. Now, I'm not saying they say everything about what the Word is. They say some really important things I want to point out. It says, the Word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Let's look at living and powerful. Why does the Scripture describe itself? Why is the Word of God living and powerful? Because it is. That's good. Who's the author of the Word? It's God Himself. God inspired these men to write down the Word. And because God is living and powerful, the Word is living and powerful. If God could come and speak to us, He would say things that are in alignment with what He has already said, because God doesn't change. And so when we open the Word of God, we're listening to the words of God. Think about what we talked about, the sayings of God. What has God said? We ought to apply those things to our lives, right? We ought to use them in battle against the enemy. We ought to use them to touch the hearts of other people. So the Word of God is alive and powerful. It says it's sharper than any two-edged sword in existence. Look at what it said. It says sharper than any two-edged sword. It describes it as a two-edged sword, and we talked about the dagger and that kind of thing. There's two edges to that, right? You can say that the Word can comfort and nourish us, but the Word can also cut us, right? You can look at the Christian that's nourished and improved and whose lives are changed by the Word, and then you can look at those that refuse to believe in Christ, who they're going to receive judgment with that same sword. God is going to be the healer to the Christian, but He's going to be the executioner to the unbeliever. The Word of God is powerful. It's alive. It's sharp. It says that the Word pierces, right? It says piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This piercing, and think of Ross and the ice pit if you want to. The Word pierces our hearts, does it not? Do you remember when you were saved, by the way? When you were saved, on the night that you were saved, on the day that you were saved, was that the very first time you heard the gospel, or had you heard it before? And if you had heard it before 1,000 times like I had, why didn't it work before? It never pierced my heart before. And on that night that I was saved, the Word of God pierced my heart. He opened up my life and made me realize where I was and where I needed to be, and the forgiveness of sin that I need. He made me realize all that. It pierced all the way down to the center of my being and made me realize that I needed to be saved. Look at what it says. It says it pierces to the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow, is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This, and by the way, the joints and marrow is not a physical thing. He's talking about spiritual things here in all three of those statements. These are things that only God can do. Man cannot divide soul and spirit, joints and marrow, and be a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. We can look at people, and they can say something, and we can perceive a meaning, and we may be totally off base. We talked about that in Sunday school. how Carol can hear somebody say something, and I'm hearing the conversation too, and I got my hearing aids turned up so I can actually hear. And so, you know, she hears them say one thing, and I hear them say something completely different. And that's because we're not even perfect hearers, are we? And we certainly can't discern what's in somebody's heart. Well, they can't be acting like that if they're calling themselves a Christian. They must not be saved. We don't know that. They may be having a really bad day, and they may be stuck in sin. They may be waiting for you to come and help pull them out of sin, to remind them that they belong to Christ. Because we all stray, don't we? I do. And so we can't determine what's inside somebody's mind or what's in somebody's heart. Nobody can do that but God. That's what the Word of God does. And so just want to point this out to you. The Word of God, this sharp sword, this two-edged sword, this powerful living Word that cuts us down to the core, if you want to call that, if you want to use that phrase. The Word comes for the believer first. It pierces deep into the hidden part of our heart. When you read the Word of God, it pierces our hearts, goes into the deepest, darkest places where bitterness and hatred and anger and jealousy live. It goes to those places. It goes to the place where our failures and our fears and our disappointments, the things that have happened to us in the past, where those things hide away. It pierces into that place where the stubborn sins and disobedience live inside of us. The Word reaches all those things. This powerful sword of God comes in and with the precision of a skilled surgeon starts to cut things away. We talked about it, didn't we, in Sunday school? It's not comfortable when God is cutting things away from us. When He's doing surgery on our innermost being, it's a difficult process. But He cuts those things away that should not be there, so that we can be perfected, made more like Jesus, made more effective as witnesses. The Word of God comes for believers first. The hand of God comes to prepare us and make us vessels of honor, as the Scripture says, ready for the Master's use, right? And our lives become a testimony. When we study the Word of God and it reaches its potential to change us, and that's what the Word of God does. When we study the Word of God, it's intended to change our lives. When people see a changed life, we become a living, walking testimony to the power of the Word of God. And so we have to expect that, right? The sword, as I said before, becomes healing, and it becomes a powerful tool in the hands of the great physician. So the Word of God comes for the believer first. But see, then the Word of God also goes out to the unbeliever. And this sword of judgment now for unbelievers, it's still in the hands of God, still in the hands of the one who is the judge, right? And for those that don't believe it, it's going to be like the executioner with the sword in his hand. And it's difficult for us to think of God that way because He's our Father and He loves us. And He loves them. But there's something missing in this. Do people really understand that they're going to be judged by the Word of God? And if they don't, what's missing? I think it's missing us going and telling them that. Us caring enough to tell them the truth. And we tell people the truth in love so that their lives can be changed. Right? Look at verse 13. It says, there's no creature hidden from His sight. All things are naked and open to Him, to the eyes of Him to whom we must give account. That sword of the Spirit, it opens us up and God sees everything that's in us. He already sees it, but this is the analogy that the Bible gives, right? The Word comes for the unbeliever, the one who has refused to believe in Christ, refused to hear the Word of God, refused to hear God's voice. And the Word's going to condemn their unbelief. And so, we as the church, we got this thing to do called witnessing, evangelism. We've got a task set out for us that Christ didn't complete, and He doesn't need us to do His work for Him, but He's called us to do it. And he's commissioned the church to go out and tell others about Christ before it's too late for them. That's where we come in, right? He's calling us to do that work. When we allow the Word of God to prepare us and empower us, then God uses our mouths and our tongues and our voice to give the Word of God to the unbeliever. The Word of God spoken in love under the direction and power of the Holy Spirit is powerful. And it accomplishes a lot of things. You know what? When we speak the word of truth and love to people because we care about them and they know we care, and when we speak under the direction and power of the Holy Spirit, lives are going to be changed. Our life has been changed by the Word of God because we've been studying the Word of God and we've been growing as disciples. Now we're speaking to others on behalf of God. And the Holy Spirit is using us to call them into His presence so their lives can be changed. And so I promised you there'd be two warnings and a promise, didn't I? I'm going to give you the second warning. The second warning is this: don't limit the power of God's Word. Don't limit the power of God's Word. Brother Mark, how are we doing that? We limit the power of God's Word when we refuse to apply it to our own lives so that our lives will be changed. And I'm asking you right now, are you studying the Word of God diligently so that God might perfect you and make you a more effective witness, so that you might draw closer to God? People might see you as an example of the power of God. Are you doing that? Are you diligently putting in effort? When you don't study the Word of God, when you don't apply it to your life, you're limiting the power of God. Anybody know John 3:16? Can we say, how does it start? For God, that's it. For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So, the whosoever... It sounds like the invitation is out to everyone. But they have to believe. Right? When we don't tell them the truth of the gospel, when we don't give them the word of God, we're limiting the power of God. When they don't see it in our lives. And see, we can limit the power of God's word when we don't apply it to us. And we limit the power of God's word when we don't tell it to them so their lives can be changed. And I'm just giving a warning here. We should not be limiting the power of God. And when we don't study it, we don't take it in and apply it to ourselves, and we don't share it with other people, you know what we're doing? We're limiting the power of God. We're saying it's not worth sharing. And we're saying, I don't care enough about anybody to share it with them. I know it's hard. It's not easy for me. I'm not an outgoing person. I'm really not. I'm okay just being by myself and not saying anything to anybody. But God hasn't called me to that. God has called me to be bold, and that's hard. I don't want to bring up God in a conversation because I don't want everybody to look at me funny. They look at me funny anyway. And I don't need more of that. But you know what? God has called us to care enough about people to want to see their lives changed, to see them drawn to Christ. It starts when we begin to seriously study the Bible and apply it to our lives. They see our lives changed, and then we've got a leg to stand on. We go and witness. Listen, I want to tell you, you've got this issue in your life. I was where you are, and God brought me out of it. I've been studying His Word, and He said, I've got this promise, and I've got that promise, and these promises are for you too, if you'll accept them into your life. Doesn't mean everything's going to go good. In fact, I just got another warning. That's number three, isn't it? I can count. Warning number three is, if you try to study the Word of God, He's going to throw obstacles in your way. And He's going to try to push back and say, you don't need to study the Word. The enemy's going to come back against you if you try to share the gospel with somebody else. You're going to get in trouble at your workplace. You're going to get in trouble at the grocery store. And, you know, I don't want to get arrested in Kroger. That's why I don't go to Kroger. For accosting somebody in the checkout line. Hey, while we're waiting, let me tell you about Jesus. We have to follow the Holy Spirit. We have to care enough about people We can't limit the power of God. Listen, I've just given you some kind of an understanding of what some suggestions are of how to study the Bible, maybe some tips and how to set goals for yourself and that. And I think there's plenty of things you can do, but the important thing is we've got to get into the Word, and we've got to let the Word get into us and change our lives. Because when our lives change, and people are going to notice, and there's no better witnessing tool out there than the example of our own life. When we go through struggle and problems, we talked about it in Sunday school. How do you handle that? Do you fly off the handle? How do you handle those drivers, Brother Mark, that cut you off? Lord, bless them before I kill them. No, that's not the right thing. A changed life is a perfect witness to somebody else. Because you know what they want? They're going to look at you and say, man, how can they go through that struggle and still maintain their sanity? How do they get through this with a smile on their face? I know they're going through that problem, but how do they come to work every day and do their job? And wow, that's impressive. We're called to be witnesses by our example. And then we're called at the moment that the Holy Spirit puts you in the right place at the right time with the right person and gives you the right words to say. We're called to have boldness to share those words. We can't limit the power of God. I want to challenge you. I'll just do that. How's that? I want to challenge you to read the Word. And I want to remind you of the warning. We're not reading the Word, and we're not applying it to our lives. We're limiting the power of God. I warned you before that Bible study is going to be life-changing. Do you know that's also the promise that I was going to share with you? That Bible study is life-changing. Is there something you want to change in your life? Is there something going on that you want to overcome? Is there a hurt or a struggle that you need some answers on? I want to say by faith that it's in here. Now listen, there's things I'm going through that are still unresolved. But you know what I'm doing? I'm trusting God. He's going to take care of them one day. And Brother Pat, if it's on the day of the rapture or the day of my death and I go to heaven and he takes care of it on that day, he still kept his promise, didn't he? I want to challenge you to read God's Word and apply it to your life. Become that example and share the Word of God with other people. Let's not limit the power of God's Word. Let's be those witnesses He's called us to be. Let's stand together. You might be here today and you are in the midst of a struggle. And you don't have an answer for the questions that are on your mind and on your heart. And maybe you're here today and you have drifted away from God. And maybe you haven't picked up your Bible in a long time. You know, when we don't study God's Word, we're saying to Him, Lord, what You said doesn't make any difference in my life. I don't think it's important for me to read this. Folks, we've been given the Word of God. We've been given the Holy Spirit to explain the Word of God to us. We need to diligently seek God. We need to be engaged in Bible study so that we can know who God is. We draw near to Him. We can live a life of obedience to Him because we are in relationship with Him. We have to have that desire to be obedient, and then we'll become those witnesses that God has called us to be. And I want to challenge you this morning to do that. Whatever is standing in your way, why don't you give it up to God this morning? Whatever is hindering you from serving God, why don't you just give it up this morning? We've got tonight, we're going to come and we're going to talk to people on the phone about their prayer needs, and we're going to reach out to people with a phone call and invite them back to church, and we're going to be writing cards, encouraging people. And what better time to recommit yourself to God than this morning so you can come back tonight and evangelize and be that witness by reaching out to somebody else. I want to ask you, will you come to Christ this morning for Him to meet your need, for Him to change your life? He's calling you to come back to Him. Let's pray real quick. Father, we come to You in the name of Jesus. And we praise You for what You're doing, God. We praise You for the Holy Spirit who lives in us and who becomes our teacher of this wonderful, powerful Word, this living Word. God, I pray that You would instill in us a greater desire to know who You are, to draw near. near to you, to become obedient to you, so that we might be better witnesses to you. God, I pray that we lay down everything that might be standing in our way, God, and we give ourselves to you completely, Father. Whatever need there is, if there's someone here that has drifted away from you, I pray that you would draw them back by your Holy Spirit. If there's somebody here that's never given their life to you, Father, I pray they'd understand that they have sin in their life that needs to be forgiven, just like we do. But Lord, when we come to Christ, we have to believe that He died on the cross to forgive that sin, to pay the penalty for sin. We believe that He is calling us to repent of that sin and to start following Him. Lord, we know that if we'll accept Him, accept that forgiveness, and begin to walk with Him, God, we know that we'll be saved. I pray that if there's someone that's lost, that's listening to this message, God, they would come to you. God, I pray that you would take us, change us, Lord, by the power of your word. Pray in Christ's name. Amen. If you need to come and pray, you can.
Finding myself at a loss for words, and the fun of things, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you will say, word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God speak.
Appreciate you guys being here and listening. I hope you picked up some information that will help you in your Bible study. But more than anything, I pray that you would, if you're already studying the Bible, that you would take another step forward and be more diligent in your study. Be more purposeful. You know, God has a reason for us being here, and Bible study is a big part of that. That's what empowers us to do the work that God has called us to do. You need to be in your Bible. If you haven't been studying your Bible lately, I want to ask you, come back to the Bible. You know that that's where God speaks to us. The song said, word of God speak. If you're not reading the word of God, what voices are you listening to? If you're not hearing God speak to you, whose voices are you listening to? I just pray that you would come back out. Anybody got a word of testimony from the Lord this morning?
Y'all listen, my heart is about to explode right now. My dad just gave his life to Christ this morning.
Amen. Thank you,
Lord. Yes.
Lord, we just pray. So two things can be seen out of that. He's 60 years old. It is not too late. It's never too late.
That's right.
And if you've been praying for somebody, don't give up.
Amen.
Don't give up. Okay.
Amen. That's awesome. Amen. Anybody else? What about a word of praise? God done anything good for you this past week? How about this? Are you expecting God to do something good for you this coming week? Amen.
He's always good.
He is good all the time, isn't he? All the time.
Pastor, my life passed away almost 3 years ago.
Yes.
And I prayed every day, every day. There's nothing happened. But one morning, something told me to get on my knees.
That's right.
And I did. And he just didn't love
me. Yes, sir.
And he had what we missed.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
He's got her comfort, isn't he? God of peace. Praise her with that testimony. Who else?
I'm going to meet your brothers.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Praise the Lord for my kids and the safety of them throughout the week, this past week.
Who else? Are you done? We're going to close out of prayer. Don't forget, tonight at 5 o'clock, we're going to be coming and doing evangelism. If you haven't done this before, we did this a few years back. We had a really good time talking to people, telling about Christ, inviting them back to church, sending cards of encouragement to people, praying with people on the phone about their needs. If you haven't done that before, you need to come and participate in that. It's a blessing to be able to reach out to others and share Christ with them, share God's love with them. So come back at 5 o'clock, and you can be in one of those groups. Yes? Yeah. We need to say happy birthday to Jim.
Do we have any others? Are there any other birthdays?
Miss Carol.
I do not my sons.
Yeah.